Hello everybody, I hope you're all well. This video is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform for building your brand or your business with a beautiful website, whether it's to sell your products, your content, or your time. If you've spent any time on TikTok, and I know I start a lot of my videos with, if you've spent any time on TikTok, because I spend a lot of time on TikTok, unfortunately, you would know that people have a little bit of an obsession with the upper class. And hey, don't we all? I like to get a little bit of my ridiculously rich people content on TikTok, whether it's massive mansion tours, designer handbag closet tours, what my private chef made for me today, or my personal favorite, what it's like to fly first class. We can all admit that we like to have a little bit of a dabble and see what they're all up to. But something which I think has especially interested TikTok within the past few months, probably the past year, is the idea of old money, quiet luxury, and stealth wealth. I think a lot of people are finding themselves tired of seeing the Kardashians decked all out in designer, also them hiring out a literal private island so they could socialize during the pandemic, are tired of logo mania. People are tired of seeing LA mega mansions that are deprived of any character. Some people think that influencers posting pictures in brand new designer in every single post to be a little bit tacky, maybe a little bit thoughtless. And this is why the idea of old money and quiet luxury has caught a lot of people's attention. Old money basically means money which has been inherited through multiple familial generations rather than earned. There is a little bit more to it, but we'll delve into it later. The old money aesthetic, which has gained quite a bit of popularity on TikTok, and the clothing associated with it are things like cashmere sweaters, logoless or minimal logo designer pieces, sweater vests, polos, Chanel two pieces, Chanel in general, pearls, business wear like loafers, blazers, suit trousers, shirts, blouses, sportswear for rich people's sports, as I like to call them, so sports like tennis or polo, and muted colors such as cream, beige, navy, and black. And it's about looking sort of put together, classy, and sophisticated. And by the way, this whole look, it was unintentional, but I feel like I'm looking quite quiet luxury today. And quiet luxury often goes hand in hand with old money. Flair magazine defines quiet luxury as a form of high-end fashion that speaks volumes through its understated elegance, careful craftsmanship, and attention to detail. Quiet luxury is all about quality over quantity, focusing on creating timeless pieces that will never go out of style. Quiet luxury is basically a language that only the wealthy understand. Quiet luxury brands are also known as you know if you know brands. Some quiet luxury brands that I found online were The Row, Objets Dasso, Fear of God, Totem, Hunting Season, Max Mara, Savette, Loro Piana, Bottega Veneta, Kate, Celine, Tove, Jill Sander, and Brunello Cucinelli. There are a multitude of different factors as to why quiet luxury and old money are being spoken about so much recently. Obviously, the natural procession of the trend cycle. Logos and logo mania were really, really popular in the late 2010s and the early 2020s. So people are simply seeking out something different. But there are also four big things which have happened recently, which I think have helped spark this interest in old money and quiet luxury. Firstly, Sophia Richie, influencer and model and daughter of Lionel Richie, got married to music exec Elliot Grange in the south of France. They had this very beautiful wedding. It was all reported on by Vogue magazine, and it took TikTok by storm, to say the least. And people were very shocked, surprised, interested, taken with, sorry, I don't know why I'm saying so many describing words, so many verbs, at how Sophia had supposedly transformed herself from Scott Disick's Instagram baddie girlfriend to quiet luxury wife of a music exec. And I just want to say very quickly that I think a lot of this discourse around her wedding is absurd, but we'll be talking more about it later. Secondly, the release of the final season of Succession. Succession stars, rise up, it's your time. Yes, the third episode got spoiled for me on Twitter. If you're going to tweet about Succession, use the hashtag. Please. Succession centers around the Roy family, and the patriarch, Logan Roy, is the CEO of this multi-billion dollar company called Waystar Royco. And it basically surrounds who he is going to eventually pass the business down to, who is going to take over from him as CEO out of his kids, Kendall, Roman, Shiv. Obviously, you have to mention Connor, but he's basically not in the running.
The butter is too cold!
And because it's a show which centers around billionaires, there's a lot of rich people shit going on, including a lot of rich people clothes. And also Gwyneth Paltrow being sued for $300,000 by ophthalmologist Terry Sanderson after they collided with each other in a ski accident in 2016. And she was also countersuing him for one single dollar. And already the internet were a little bit obsessed with this case because it was just all a bit absurd. But also people were really interested in Gwyneth Paltrow's court wear. People were labeling it as Wealth Whispers fashion. On the second day of court, she was wearing a G-Label by Goop cream jumper priced at £500, a moss green wool coat by The Row priced at £3,900, Prada boots priced at £1,150, and G-Label by Goop gold jewelry. And this isn't a visibly designer outfit, and I think that's why people are so interested in this, that celebrities spend so much money on clothes that honestly, it could look like they're from Zara. Like, I don't doubt that the quality is amazing, but... And lastly, Coachella was on a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago now, and something which, I know this seems a little bit out of left field, but hear me out. Something which caught a lot of people's eyes was how obviously influencers were dressing to the absolute nines as usual. Meanwhile, celebrities like Kendall and Kylie Jenner, Hailey Bieber, even Emma Chamberlain were choosing to dial it back a little bit and wear very plain clothing, when in previous years they had gone all out. And again, we're going to talk about this more later, no spoilers, but I do think this Coachella difference in style relates a lot to how old money versus new money conversations is a lot less about how long the money has technically been in your family for, and it's a lot more about how you behave with said money. And I think some celebrities choosing to strip it back for Coachella was maybe a way of them separating themselves from influencers. Are celebrities versus influencers the new old money versus new money? We'll be talking about that today. And just before we get into it, I would love to thank today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is the perfect all-in-one platform to engage your audience by building a beautiful website, whether you're selling products, content, or your time. A few Squarespace tools that stand out to me as a creator is, first of all, the wide range of pre-made templates, which makes creating a beautiful website so easy. Also, members areas, where you can sell access to gated content, whether it's videos, online courses, newsletters. It's just a great way to diversify your income. You can also connect all of your social media accounts to your website. So whether you want to share your website with your followers, or more importantly, you can actually display your social media posts on your website. A really important part about building your brand and your business is knowing who your audience are. And as a YouTuber, I spend a lot of my time on analytics, more than I'm willing to admit. And with the Squarespace analytics tools, you can discover where your site visits are coming from and improve your website based on your most popular keywords, your most popular content, products. So make sure you go to squarespace.com for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/JordanTeresa for 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Thank you again, Squarespace, for sponsoring this video. Old money money is money which is inherited rather than earned. And it's typically inherited through multiple familial generations. It's usually an asset rather than like actual cash money. So businesses, property, land, I don't know. Examples of old money families are the Vanderbilts, who were once the wealthiest family in the world, who gained prominence during the Gilded Age. Their success began with the shipping and railroad empires of Cornelius Vanderbilt, and the family expanded into various other areas of industry and philanthropy. Contemporary descendants of the Vanderbilts who live on the East Coast include art historians, journalists, musicians, screenwriters, and dukes. Another example of an old money family is the Bush family. Yeah, that Bush. An American dynastic family that is prominent in the fields of American politics, news, sports, entertainment, and business. Mostly known for their involvement in politics, family members have held various offices across four generations, such as being senators, governors, and of course, not producing just one, but two presidents, George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush. And other notable family members include an NFL executive and multiple TV personalities. And new money is money which is earned rather than inherited. And if it is inherited, it's only been in the family for a generation or two. Examples of new money is most tech bros like Bill Gates, who created Microsoft, Mark Zuckerberg, who created Facebook and Meta. But also another really good example of new money is the Kardashians, who their dad was a very famous lawyer, Robert Kardashian, and now they are reality stars turned business moguls. But in my opinion, I think old money versus new money is a lot less about how long the money has been in your family before and a lot more about how you act with the money and behave with the money. I've seen the phrase money talks, wealth whispers be thrown around a lot recently, which I'm pretty sure is a rendition of new money shouts, old money whispers. Old money is typically associated with a classy and sophisticated dress sense, still expensive clothing, but typically logoless or very minimal logos, being classy in general and having good etiquette. I mean, I don't really believe that's a real thing, but whatever. Being privately educated or going to boarding school, living on the East Coast, posh people's sports such as polo, tennis, horse riding, bowls, I don't know, mansions, 19th century architecture. And although people from old money families may not say this so blatantly now because it's looked down upon, but I could be wrong, old money people don't like class mixing. They do not like class mixing. As in, they only want to associate with people of the upper classes, people like them. Which is why a lot of old money people don't like people that come from new money, because they believe that it's upsetting the social order that's already in place. Meanwhile, new money is often associated with visibly designer clothing and logo mania, being famous, often along the lines of like reality TV, maybe you like to call the paparazzi on yourself, living on the West Coast, modern architecture and new build mansions, sports cars, and just embracing modernity in general, whether it's cars, clothing, music, or social media usage. In general, being quite flashy, maybe being a little bit frivolous with your wealth, maybe even being slightly reckless with your wealth because you've just come into your money. I think people have this tendency to glamorize old money. Like, look how classy they are. They don't feel the need to flaunt their wealth to people the way that reality stars do, the way that the Kardashians do. But if we're being honest with ourselves, guys, old money people probably aren't that nice. People with old money don't feel the need to flaunt their wealth because they don't want to mix with other people from different classes, period. They're flaunting their wealth to the upper classes, which is why they're wearing a lot of quiet luxury brands, you know if you know brands. Also, I'm pretty sure Mina Leigh spoke about this in her video about the old money aesthetic, but people who are from old money tend to have a lot more skeletons in their closet, to put it very lightly. One example being that some old money families, probably a lot of old money families, if they had businesses and industries in the 1700s and 1800s, it was probably built off the back of the slave trade. And that isn't to say that exploitation doesn't happen today because slavery is illegal. Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon, Amazon would not have been able to build up such a ludicrous amount of wealth if he didn't exploit his workers. Amazon is infamous for really poor working conditions, union busting. I think something which is interesting to look at, and I know that a lot of people are going to disagree with me when I say this, but I think something which is interesting to look at is the way over here in the UK, older people specifically treat the Kardashians versus the royal family. Now, stay with me. And this isn't to say that the Kardashians should be free and exempt of all criticism. If you spend 5 minutes on my channel, you know that I've criticized that family a lot. They've built their entire empire off of young women's insecurities, but that's a conversation for another day. But just to use the royal family as an example, people, especially older people, tend to look down on the Kardashians more than they look down on the royal family. They believe the Kardashians are tacky, they flaunt their wealth too much, they're out of touch. The royal family are the ultimate representation of old money. They are worth quite literally hundreds of millions of pounds. King Charles inherited hundreds of millions of pounds, whether it was in cash money, whether it's in property, from Queen Elizabeth, and didn't pay a penny of inheritance tax. And may I add, obviously, that all of this money is public money. It's money which British people pay in taxes. Their lifestyle is quite literally funded by the people of this country. And we live in one of the most grossly unequal countries in the world. Yet so many people love them, especially it's more older people that love them. They see them as so classy and sophisticated, and they make you proud to be British. Like, it very much is the opposite effect on me. It actually makes me feel ashamed to be British that we spent £115 million of public money on the coronation whilst there are children, families who are literally having to choose between heating their homes and eating. I do just find it interesting that there are some people that think the Kardashians are tacky and out of touch and that they flaunt their wealth, but will hang up a Union Jack in their window in time for the coronation. Like, don't you think that holding a coronation during a time of gross inequality in this country and political unrest, when there are people that are literally starving, can't afford to pay their energy bills, can't afford to feed themselves or their children, food bank usage has gone up in this country. Whilst all of this is going on, they've spent over £100 million of public money on a coronation which is being broadcasted to millions of people, but that isn't seen as them flaunting their wealth. And people from old money do not like people who are new money. They are so rigid in their belief system that they believe that people that come into their money really quickly, whether they started a business, got famous, won the lottery, that they are disturbing the social order. And because of this, people who are from old money will be constantly adapting and changing their lifestyle to separate themselves from those who are new money. And people from new money often follow suit because they want to look like they're from old money or that they belong with old money. Some people who are new money don't want to be seen as tacky and frivolous and flashy. Again, this is only some people that are new money. Not all new money people care about old money approval. As I said earlier, Flair magazine defines quiet luxury as a form of high-end fashion that speaks volumes through its understated elegance, careful craftsmanship, and attention to detail. Quiet luxury is all about quality over quantity, focusing on creative, timeless pieces that will never go out of style. Quiet luxury clothing brands are typically very expensive and very good quality, but most importantly, are not noticeably designer. They either have very minimal logos or are completely logoless, and you may think people who have adopted this quiet luxury lifestyle that because they're choosing to dial it back on the designer and logo front, that they're not trying to catch anyone's attention. But it's quite the opposite, in fact. They're just trying to catch the right people's attention. Quiet luxury brands are typically referred to as you know if you know brands. It's a language which only the wealthy understands. Wealthy people don't care about what working class or middle class or even some upper class people think of them, but they do care about what very wealthy people think of them. Very wealthy people are their peers at the end of the day. And I also think that quiet luxury is a way for some rich people to separate themselves from who they view as tacky rich people. But let's talk about Succession. I absolutely love Succession. It's one of my favorite shows. Conhead, I'm a Conhead, guys. And Kieran Culkin revealed that they actually have wealth advisors helping the writers so they can tell them how actual wealthy people behave. A couple of examples that he gave was that wealthy people don't duck for helicopters because they've gotten in and out of helicopters so many times. They know where the propellers are. Also, wealthy people usually don't own a winter coat because they're usually just in buildings and then being driven wherever they need to go. But let's actually talk about the clothes. Now, I could sit here all day and talk about the clothing in Succession because it's so interesting. But one episode which really stood out to me was an episode in season 4 when they all go to Norway to meet Madsen. It's got most of the characters in it, and also they're in an environment that they're not typically in. So we've got to see some very interesting style choices. Shiv is the queen of quiet luxury. Let's not get it twisted. At the beginning of the episode, she was wearing a $398 the standard silk shirt with a $670 Copernic pinstripe wool vest and a $725 Max Mara pinstripe wool pants. And by the way, guys, that's a pretty cheap outfit for Succession terms. Later in the episode in Norway, she is seen wearing a Maxine 2-in-1 trench coat priced at $1,190 and Altuzura Finis leather blazer priced at $1,195 and a $1,880 Ralph Lauren elbow patch blazer and a $1,090 Ralph Lauren turtleneck. And I feel like I cannot talk about Shiv without talking about this insane blazer that she wore to her and Tom's election party, which is priced at $2,890. Jerry was also serving in this episode, as she always does, and is seen wearing a $4,495 Brunello Cucinelli corduroy blazer, and Carl was seen wearing a Paul Stewart Belsette quilted field coat priced at $1,995. Tom was also wearing Brunello Cucinelli, a $2,995 cashmere knit down vest to be exact, and those white trainers that he was wearing that Shiv was picking on him for were $795 Todd's IT sneakers. And something which I absolutely love about Succession is the attention to detail. Whilst Tom was wearing a Herno Giacca jacket priced at $855, Greg was wearing an overshirt jacket from Uniqlo priced at just $49.90. I couldn't actually find that many details about what Kendall was wearing in that episode, but in episode 7, Kendall wears his famous depression baseball cap. It's a $625 Thai baseball cap with $1,195 Loro Piana sneakers, and for Shiv and Tom's election party, he is wearing a Tom Ford jacket priced at a whopping, guys, $6,990. And some bonus outfits throughout the season, because why not? In episode 5, Roman is seen wearing a $598 Polo Ralph Lauren cardigan, and Willa is wearing a $490 Sandro Tweed Trompe L'Oeil dress. Greg's dates ludicrously capacious bag.
Ludicrously capacious bag.
What?
What's even in there? Huh? Flat shoes for the subway? Her lunch pail?
In episode 1, it's a $2,890 Burberry vintage check leather satchel bag, but we all knew it was Burberry. It was ludicrously capacious. Carrie in episode 1, who I need her to be presenting the news, guys. I need her to be presenting the news.
Police. Missouri State Police. Have oh my issued goodness. An
she should have been presenting the election, okay? Is wearing this stunning Sergio Hudson wool two-piece suit. The blazer is priced at $1,895 and the pants are priced at $1,195. And also in episode 1, Kendall is wearing a $5,990 Tom Ford light suede bomber. And I think the reason why Succession specifically has sparked such an interest in quiet luxury and stealth wealth is because Succession is one of the very few shows that gets wealth right. Like, this is actually how wealthy people behave, down to the really big things, like only being interested in politics when it benefits your business, hence why so many rich people are Republicans and conservatives, aligning themselves with the most right-wing and fascist presidents just because it's going to benefit their business. And also, a lot of the time, Democrats of people of who are super, super rich are just as bad as the Republicans, down to the really small details about how they dress, how they get in and out of a helicopter. Succession is one of, if not the first exposure that normal people like you and me have to the ultra wealthy. And again, I didn't write this in the script. Oh, I'm going off script, guys. But again, to relate to my point about how old money versus new money discourse is a lot more about how you behave with the money rather than how long the money has been in your generation for, it's because technically the Roys are new money. Logan is self-made. So this exorbitant amount of wealth has only been in the family for one generation. Yet we view the Roy family as old money because of the way they behave and act with their money. Now let's finally talk about Sophia Richie's wedding. Sophia Richie, who is a model and an influencer, and also the daughter of Lionel Richie, got married to Elliot Grange, the founder and CEO of indie record label 10K Projects. They had a beautiful wedding in the south of France. I literally saw it all over TikTok. It got covered by Vogue. She wore three beautiful Chanel wedding dresses. I was actually quite surprised at how invested people were in this wedding because I hadn't really heard anything about Sophia Richie in a few years. And also I was sort of expecting this kind of reaction over the Nicola Peltz and Brooklyn Beckham wedding. And on TikTok is where the discourse, dun dun dun, discourse derogatory, the discourse started cropping up about Sophia Richie rebranding herself as quiet luxury, how she married into old money. And to start this conversation off, I guess we kind of have to talk about Sophia Richie's past. Sophia Richie was still a pretty well-known influencer and model, but something that a lot of people knew her for was that she dated Scott Disick, Kourtney Kardashian's ex-boyfriend and father of their, I think it's three children, maybe four, I don't know. And Scott Disick and Sophia Richie began dating when she was just 19 and he was 34. And people use this along with her style at the time when she was 19 and comparing it to now, her marrying a music exec and having sort of a more quiet luxury aesthetic, as like the ultimate rebrand. How Sophia Richie successfully rebranded herself into quiet luxury. It's just so unbelievable how Sophia Richie went from girlfriend of Scott Disick to marrying a music exec in the south of France and being covered by Vogue. And I do just want to preface this by saying that maybe I'm a little bit naive to how the Hollywood PR machine works, but I feel like labeling the style change that Sophia Richie had between the ages of 19 to 24 as a quiet luxury rebrand is a little bit silly. Like, let's everyone take a step back and think about their style when they were 19. Da, da, da. Technically, we've all had a rebrand. Also, I think people complimenting Sophia Richie on her rebrand is so, like, belittling and backhanded. Like, imagine if you went up to your friend and went, oh my god, I love the way you've completely changed your style. Like, am I the only person that thinks it's a little bit rude? And I've seen people hotly debating on TikTok whether Sophia Richie is truly quiet luxury or not. And I'm not going to be talking about that today because I really don't care enough. But I do think people have a tendency to project their own fantasies onto celebrities that they don't know. And people on TikTok have crafted their own narrative and just projected it onto Sophia Richie. Sophia Richie was this Instagram baddie who was dating this bad boy Scott Disick, and then she got out from it and now she's marrying into old money, a music exec in the south of France, and it's all being covered by Vogue. She's cleaned herself up and now she's married into old money and now she's a quiet luxury queen. Instagram baddie to quiet luxury queen pipeline, which I don't think is true. Now, first of all, I hate that people are boiling down the entirety of Sophia Richie's personhood into who she dated when she was 19 years old. First of all, I see a lot more people criticizing Sophia Richie for her relationship with Scott Disick rather than Scott Disick himself, the man that was in his mid-30s that had a history of dating only 19-year-old girls. And It's probably because Scott is a man, and also he's a bit charismatic and a bit funny, and he did some funnies on Keeping Up with the Kardashians 10 years ago that people just let it slide with him. They give him a pass whilst in the same breath defining the entirety of Sofia Richie's character to the relationship she had when she was a 19-year-old. And I don't know whether people are doing it intentionally or unintentionally. And also this narrative that people have curated about Sofia Richie marrying into old money isn't actually true. By the way, I got all of these predicted net worths off the internet, which are infamously not always right. So take this with a pinch of salt. But I feel like my point still stands. Both Sofia Richie and her husband Elliot Grange's net worth is predicted to be similar, around $10 million. And Elliot Grange's dad is Lucian Grange, who is the CEO of, I think it's Universal Music. I haven't written this down for some reason. Basically, he's the CEO of a really, really big music production company. So Lucian's net worth is predicted to be anything from $50 million to $450 million. It's quite difficult to point down, but let's just stick it at a median at like $200 million. Are we forgetting that Sofia Richie is the daughter of Lionel Richie? Oh, Ned Long. Oh, Ned. And Lionel's predicted net worth is $250 million. And Lionel and Lucian are both self-made. So technically, both Sofia and Elliot are new money nepo babies. And I don't even mean that in the derogatory sense. I mean that in the factual sense. And I think the reason why people are creating this narrative that Sofia Richie married into old money and was swept off her feet is because I think it's a fantasy that a lot of people wish for themselves. I think most people dream of falling in love with someone who is super rich and old money and being swept off their feet and having their lives completely transformed, and them in the process be completely transformed. It's basically like a fairy tale. And this is the last thing I'm going to say on the matter, but Sofia Richie's style when she was 19 wasn't bad. It was actually good. She just dressed very for the time. It was very 2018, 2019 Instagram baddie, but she was serving. She looked good. Just to round this video off, I thought I would talk about Coachella and celebrities and influencers and their styling differences this year. And I know it seems a little bit random, but I feel like it relates a lot to how old money versus new money discourse is a lot more about how you act with your money and a lot less about how long the money has been in your family for. Sorry, I feel like I've said that so many times in this video. This year's Coachella, we actually saw a little bit of a styling differences between some celebrities versus influencers. Influencers were obviously going all out, dressing to the nines, and they look good. And I'm not usually invested in Coachella fashion because I am from the UK. We have a very different approach to festivals. And whenever I see Coachella outfits, despite the fact that they look gorgeous, I always think that it must be so impractical. But doesn't take away from the fact that influencers were serving versus some celebrities like Kendall and Kylie Jenner, even Emma Chamberlain, Hailey Bieber, were choosing to dial it back a little bit for Coachella. And to be fair, for Emma Chamberlain, I don't really think that's out of character. I watch literally all of her videos and she dresses down a lot. So I don't really see that as that out of left field. But Kendall and Kylie Jenner and Hailey Bieber were people that typically dressed to the nines for Coachella. I think something which is important to talk about when discussing Coachella is the fact that Coachella is a business event for a lot of people, typically influencers and some celebrities, which is why they go all out when it comes to the outfits, the hair, the makeup, because it will drive engagement on their own social media. They'll gain new followers. They could also be featured in publications. You could meet other influencers and get opportunities there. Like, there's just a lot of opportunities within Coachella. It is a business event for a lot of people. And this is the same for celebrities like the Kylie Jenners, or should I say, was the same. Perhaps, and this is just a theory, by the way, Coachella isn't really a business event for celebrities like the Kylie Jenners anymore. They don't have to worry about what they're wearing because they don't really care for it anymore. They don't really need the press. Maybe they are just there to enjoy the music. And perhaps it's become less of a business event for them because of the large influx of influencers going to Coachella that we have seen in sort of the last 5 to 10 years. Even though Coachella is still wildly expensive, with the introduction of brands taking influencers to Coachella, Coachella has become ever so slightly more attainable to the average person. But I do feel like these influencer celebrities like the Kylie Jenners, like Hailey Bieber, who were previously thought of as new money, now view influencers as the new money, if that makes sense. And they want to move up in that hierarchy. And maybe them dressing down for Coachella versus influencers dressing up is maybe their way of trying to separate themselves from influencers. Is trying too hard for Coachella going to become tacky? Who knows? By the way, I don't think there's any such thing as trying too hard. If anything, I love it when people try really hard with their fashion. I think it's fun. Maybe they're doing this because they want the public to view them differently from how the public view influencers. Maybe now that influencers are dressing to the absolute nines for Coachella, I feel like I've said that so much, wearing these really beautiful, lavish outfits has become ever so slightly more attainable and ever so slightly more mainstream. So they have to separate themselves from that. Maybe. Or I could just be chatting a load of rubbish and they just wanted to be comfortable. I am really interested though in how some celebrities dressing down for Coachella is going to impact the future of Coachella fashion. And look, I'm not usually that invested in Coachella fashion, but now I am. I feel like if people and influencers begin to follow suit and are choosing to dress down, I feel like it's really going to separate those who really love fashion from those who are just trend followers. But yes, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I actually had a lot of fun filming it and writing it also. If you enjoyed it, thumbs up, leave a comment, subscribe, follow socials, follow podcast, follow everything, follow all my stuff. But yeah, I'll see you guys soon for another video. Bye.